Hello everyone. I hope this presentation finds you in good health. My name is Prajit Keshava Prasad and I work as an Associate Software Engineer at Red Hat, Bangalore, India. I joined Red Hat 1 year back. I joined as an intern. I got converted around February of this year. So to talk a bit about me, I read books and I like developing software applications. I do a lot of projects and I love to automate things. And right now I'm diving into my interests are dived into decentralized systems and its architectures. And I'd like to take a moment to thank our overt event organizers because it wouldn't have been easy to conduct such an event during the unfortunate times of our lives. So, and also I kind of feel a bit weird talking to myself on a camera and presenting this alone, but it does have its fun moments and also it has its own advantages. So yeah, let's start the presentation. So I'm going to be talking about replacing cluster hosts from covert engine. So why do we need this feature in overt? So previously, since this feature was not there, users usually go to users would follow a long steps of manual setups that users would have to do in order to replace their host in a cluster. It involved a lot of tedious tasks like cluster peer restoration, volume restoration, and other things. So the aim of this feature is to simply provide an easy way for users to replace their host, also with the minimum number of interventions. So what is replace host? So it's pretty self-explanatory, I know that, but what I really intend to speak here about this is about the two types of replace host, that is same node FQDN and the different node FQDN. So same node FQDN means you're replacing a physical node by cleaning it up and adding the same node back to the cluster. And different node means you're replacing a physical machine with another one. Even though this is what the name indents, you can even cross work it out if you understand the architecture. It's basically like if I have a node and it fails and it gets corrupted. So I take it out, I clean it completely, I even put in a freshly installed ISO, and then once I do that, I change my host name. So now it has become the same physical machine but with different IP address or different host name. So then I'd have to follow different FQDN procedure. So it's basically it's up to us on how to proceed with the option. So before I dive into how it's implemented in overt engine, I'd like to talk about the implementation that it's been there in cluster Ansible. So replace host has been there in cluster Ansible for quite some time, but for some time it has been only implemented for peer reconfiguration, and also it was just for same node FQDN. So recently we have updated for different node FQDN and also for different node FQDN. So basically cluster Ansible provides a CLI way for you to completely replace the host. So for example, even if if your node is corrupted, even from the disk level, then you could, once you install a freshly node ISO or something, then you can, do a cleanup, and then the node would be prepared, like creation of LVs and VGs would be done, and then peer restoration and the volume restoration, for which we'll be seeing that what that means in just a moment. But all those stuffs will happen, and then your node will be automatically added back to the cluster. So this has been there. This has been there in the cluster Ansible maintenance. So if you are interested in doing a CLI replace host, feel free to check that out. And yeah, so coming back, so before I dive into the Overt engine, replacing cluster in Overt engine, it's important to understand the variables that we use here. So we are basically using four types of variables. Four variables, and first one is cluster maintenance old node. So this is basically the node which is corrupted and which needs to be replaced. The second one is cluster Ansible new node. So if you're going with same node FQDN, old node and new node should be having the same FQDN, because new node represents the node which is going to be which is replacing the corrupted node. And if you're going with a different node FQDN, then old node and the new node can be different. Then the cluster Ansible maintenance node, that is a node which is not the old node but in the cluster. So it's basically, let's say that to say it with an example, let's say there are three hosts in a cluster and host B is corrupted. Host A would be maintenance cluster node and host C would be the maintenance cluster node too. So coming back to the actual topic, there are three, types here, not types, there are three essential points that completely sums up the cluster Ansible, that completely sums up the replace host. So before I speak about this, I'd like to talk a minute about how the entire function or the entire feature works in Overt engine. So basically, if you want to replace a host, you generally, once the node becomes corrupted, you take it out, you clean it up, maybe you even install a new, freshly installed ISO or something, and then once that is done and once it's added back in Overt UI, you do a reinstall. So it installs all the packages, and once that is done, when you select reinstall, you'll be able to see an option for replacing host, and once you click that, you'll be able to see whether what type of replace host that you want to proceed with. Either is it same node or is it a different node. So you can choose whichever you want accordingly, and then once you click choose that and you click OK, and it begins reinstallation. So after it reinstalls all the packages, it follows these all tasks which is mentioned here. So authorization, PS, and volume restoration. And once everything is successfully done, when it means that your host has successfully been reinstalled and replaced. So this is what a replace host completely means. This is what replace host complete flow looks like. So coming back to the three core essential points, the first one is authorization. So authorization is just a task which would require SSH pass keys. So let's say that again, I'll be explaining the entire slides with different examples. So you'll be hearing a lot of host A, host B, and host C's. So let's take an example of host A, host B, and host C here. And let's say host B is corrupted. So when host B is the one to be, host B, since host B is corrupted, you are trying to replace host B with a new one. So once you're added, it's important that host B be accessible, that is the new host B be accessible from host A and host C without the password. So that's what this authorization is all about. It will basically copy the authorized keys to the new node, so that it can access the new node without the password. This is what authorization task does. The next one is the peer restoration task. So the peer reconfiguration or the peer restoration, before I explain peer restoration, again, I'd like to interject and I'd like to explain about clusters peer status, cluster peers work. So I'm not going to go deep into how clusters peer internally works, but I'm just going, I'll try to cover the overall sense of how it works. So again, let's go back to our host A, host B, and host C. And host B is the one which is corrupted. Let's not talk about corrupted now. Let's just understand cluster, sorry. So there are three hosts, host A, host B, and host C. And you want to, you know, create a cluster here using the peer mechanism. So from host A, you peer probe host B and host C. There is a command called as cluster peer probe and the host name. So you do that from host A, and then you do that from B or C. So once you do all that, from A, if you check cluster peer status, you will be seeing, B and C added in the peer status. And similarly in B, you'll be able to see A and C. And in C, you'll be able to see A and B's cluster peers. So this means that there is a cluster peer network or cluster peer cluster has been created. A cluster has basically been created. So this is what cluster peer mechanism works. And later on, it can further be used. So since cluster peer, there is a cluster, then there are different types of clusters like distribute, replicate, all those file systems can be built on top and then files can be shared. So that is the primary reason why the peer is basically being used. But yeah, that is, of course, other topic. So coming back into peer reconfiguration. So here, let's go back to the same example of A, B, and C. In host B is the one which is now corrupted. All right. So now if you go and check host A's cluster peer status, you'll be able to see that host B's peer status as disconnected. And similarly, if you go to C, you'll be able to see the host B's status as disconnected, peer status. So now what happens is so for same node FQDN, the logic goes something like this. It will copy the peer files from host A and the peer files from host B, host C, which are required for host B, and it will copy it back to host B. And then once all the necessary peer files are copied to B, then it will restart the cluster cluster service. And once that is done, you will be seeing that the cluster peer status output would basically be it will show that the cluster is connected. Just one more point I'd like to add here is not just copying the peer files is enough. You'd basically be copying the cluster, that is the old, whichever corrupted node UUID would be, would be written into cluster.d.info file of the new node. And then your restart of cluster would happen. And then all the cluster would be up because cluster peer status would be active across the three hosts. So this is the same node FQDN, but for different node FQDN, instead of copying the old peers folders, the new, different FQDN, meaning the physical system or the architecture itself is different, the physical bare metal itself is different, or the FQDN and host name is different. What it will do is it will cluster, we'll be peer probing it to all the two hosts, so that let's say from A there will be three peers now. So peer of B, that is the corrupted node which is in rejected state, peer of C, and then peer of D that is also connected. So it's not corrupted, correct, connected. So all the threes, there will be three peers, and the new node will only be having two. So once the new node is properly attached to the cluster, there will be a process of removing the old node's peer file from both the cluster nodes. Finally, when you come out of the task, all the cluster peer status would be showing as connected across all the three hosts. So this is how the cluster peer reconfiguration task is done. So just to add one more point here, this works fine in a cluster of three hosts, but what if the cluster contains n hosts? Still, even though all the n hosts are of this, assuming all the n hosts are of the same cluster, copying just the files, you know, of two hosts wouldn't be enough. So here what happens is, all the peers, that is, so just for the sake, again we'll be using only two variables. So as I said before, there are only four variables which we get from, and with that four variables, even if out of those four variables only two of them are cluster nodes. So basically the primary reason those two cluster nodes are being used is to copy the peer files. So here, even though if there are n hosts, all the details of the peers would be there in both the two hosts. So from, you know, copying all the relevant details and then removing the old peer would give us all the other peers, relevant peers. So that's how that works. That's how the peer restoration completely works. And next is the volume restoration. So this is also similar. It runs a cluster command called as replace brick commit force, which will eventually lead in to data healing. That is, let's say that the host B is now completely active with respect to cluster peer status, and now when it goes to volume reconfiguration, it might have some three volumes. So it need to be, since the brick, if it's a different FQTN, the brick path might have changed. So in that case, it will, or running the run play replace brick commit force will help in either of the cases. It will help in replacing the brick, and then once the bricks are successfully replaced, you'll be able to see that the data will be healed across the hosts. And once data is healed, then it's safe to say that the cluster peer, it's safe to say that the replace host has been successful. That is, the replace host is successful and the host will be up in the RevUI. So now this is the fourth point called as pre-task. So this will be triggered only for, this is for a special case. So that's why I did not emphasize on this, or, you know, I did not add this as a key essential a few slides back. So to talk about pre-task, I'll have to explain the special case. So I'll be explaining it with an example. So let's say there are three hosts, A, B, and C. Now here, A, B, and C will be having the host names A, B, and C, okay? But at times, cluster might be configured as another network. So when it is configured as another network, it might not use the same, it might not use the same host name as the friend and FQTNs. So let's say that host A will have a backend cluster FQTN called as A dash, or host B will have a backend FQTN as B dash, host C as C dash. So the primary objective of pre-task is to fetch the backend FQTN from the friend and host name, because we cannot pass the friend and host name to the peers, or, you know, to the playbook, because obviously it will fail, because it will search for the peers with respect to the friend and FQTN of host A, but it won't find anything, because it's configured using the backend FQTN. So for that primary reason, the primary objective of pre-task is to fetch the backend FQTNs from the friend and friend and FQTN. It's as simple as that. So this is implemented only in the engine side. So only in the engine patch. So in the engine, basically it can check, you know, every host. Now once you go click, it will have its own virtual, network interface, and there you'll be able to loop through a series of network over temp, GMT, and the other networks. So for cluster, there is a check, or there is a mark in the DB called as this cluster would be true. So from there you can fetch the backend IP addresses, and from the IP address, once you go into the host, you'll be able to grab the backend FQTN, and then you can, you know, it will pass to the other further tasks, as you know, further tasks which I've explained in the below and in the above slides. So that is what pre-task do. So now I'd like to show you a quick demo, because this is the end of the replace host structure of how replace host works. And I believe that I've covered almost everything. So going into the demo, I just want to make a few points is that that was done by through a development setup. So developmental setup. So yeah, so let's just see how the demo works.
So here I'm having three hosts. I have partitioned my terminal into three so that I'll be able to execute same commands on the three machines. So here you can see that I'm having three hosts and all the hosts are connected by cluster peer. So cluster peer status are connected across all the three hosts. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to mess up the third host's cluster configuration. So I'll be removing the cluster peers and then restarting it so that from the third host would have no data or collection of whatsoever. It wouldn't basically remember all the prior connections it has. Kindly note that I'm actually removing the cluster D path only on the third host and not the other two. So here the third host status is in a peer rejected state. So now I'm going back to my overt engine and I'm putting the host, whichever host the cluster peer status is down, I'm putting it into maintenance. And now you can see that in the reinstall flow, you are seeing a replace host tab. So here you can choose whichever type of replace host you want to do, same node or different node. I'm doing a same node FQDN. So now it's installing. This would take 30 seconds, but it usually takes a lot of time. But here, since all of the packages are already installed, it's just going to skip that. Since it's a developmental setup, as I said before, I'll have to refresh. The page doesn't automatically refresh. So once I refresh the page, you'll be able to see that the host is up. So here you can see that the host is up now. And if I go back and check the cluster peer status everywhere, it will go back to the initial. I mean, it will go back to the old status. That is, the cluster peer status is basically now in a connected state, just as it was before. So this is the demo of the entire feature.
So I believe like I have covered everything else here. So feel free to reach out to me. I have recently joined Twitter. That's my Twitter ID. So, yep. I guess I'll be taking the questions now. So, yep. Thank you.